If you saw a patient last Wednesday and she canceled her follow-up appointment today due to a positive coronavirus test, do you have the contact tracing in place enabling you to notify every patient and team member of the potential exposure? Dr. Zach Korwin is my guest today, and that's exactly what he's going to discuss. And we're starting right now.
And now, Amazon number one best-selling author, Dr. Tom, the Gyms Guy, Orant.
Dr. Zach Korwin is a practicing general dentist in Newington, Connecticut. He's been a clinical associate professor at UPenn and Temple Dental Schools, and he's a fellow of the International College of Oral Implantologists. Zach, thank you so much for joining us. How are you doing today?
I'm doing pretty well. First day back at work in the brave new world, and things went actually better than expected. We did a lot of planning to get there, so I'm pretty happy about it.
Zach, tell me how and why you first got involved with the issue of contact tracing in dental practice.
So part of our initial strategy, as I said, was to try to make sure that the patients and the staff felt as comfortable as possible about returning to work. And early on, the CDC was recommending very strongly that dental practices have a contact tracing program in place so that if someone entered the office and then several days later tested positive for COVID, you could let your staff know and you can let your other patients know. The burden of doing that is high, and it's enough that, you know, we've been out of work for 2 months, we haven't seen patients. And in my experience recently, the first couple of days back are really crowded. So to keep track of all that stuff was difficult, but it is recommended. I mean, the CDC is saying that the best thing you can do really is do contact tracing to reduce the amount of community spread. If you're aware of someone testing positive, you can alert all the people that you know of that they've been in contact with. And so the CDC has on their website guidelines and recommendations for instituting a contact tracing program. And one of the things they recommend is a digital contact tracing program. And so as part of my program that I designed, I wanted to make sure that we could still be as compliant with CDC guidelines as possible without overburdening my front desk workers with all the myriad of other stuff that they're going to be responsible for when we return to the offices in full. So the program that I developed, as one of its features, will automatically reach out to any patient that's been in your office. It does it by email and by text message. It doesn't require any interaction from the staff. It doesn't really require any setup from you in the office. It just sort of does what it needs to do. And then when patients get the email or the text message, they reply to you and let you know whether or not they've started to have any symptoms. So this just happens automatically. It'll contact them 2 days after their appointment and 2 weeks after their appointment. This is the text message. And what'll happen is that the program automatically records who was in the office around the same day as the patient who may have tested positive. I know some practice management softwares will delete the schedule if you go back historically. So this just keeps an eye on that. And so if, God forbid, somebody ends up testing positive, you have a pretty clear list of who you need to get in touch with. And so this is a reply from a patient. This is me. When they get that email or text message, they reply, and then you get this back from them.
Okay, so why the software? What motivated you to develop? I understand the contact tracing, the whole thing makes sense, but you develop software solution for contact tracing. What motivated you to do that?
So it's a module as part of a larger software program. I'm a practicing dentist. I am chairside 5 days a week. I have several offices to manage. I'm sure that I'm not the only one who has difficulty making sure everything is done the way I want it to be at the front desk and consistently. I can't tell you how many times I've had to say, how did this patient hear about us? And my front desk says, oh, I don't know, I forgot to ask that question. So even with good scripting, it's still possible that stuff's going on, people forget to do things. So I really wanted to make sure that as our organization scales and we end up acquiring more practices, that we have a system in place that allows us to make sure that we are treating the patients well, not just dentally, but also in customer service, without intensive training. And, you know, what happens if the really great office manager leaves the practice? And so I just wanted to try to mitigate some of those risks. My staff really doesn't want to learn a new software. They don't want to log into a new thing. They don't want to keep track of a portal with all this stuff you know, that they need to now be responsible for in addition to their normal job of keeping the office running. So I thought, you know, what if I could basically have a virtual personal assistant, and instead of requiring each staff member in the office to be responsible for this stuff, what if it just, you know, did it for them? So I named it Automated Patient Experience, so we could have a good patient experience in each office in an automated fashion.
So if a dental practice were to adopt automated patient experience, you could say the dental practice has gone ape.
Yeah. I will use that.
Yeah, I would, you know, I'm just saying, and this is going to be part of the video, I'm just saying that I would be jumping and talking to a cartoon artist, getting a gorilla done and working on that right away.
I have one. I'll send it to you afterwards.
So what are some of the other features that you mentioned that it's part of a larger software? What are some of the other features, and how long would it take for a dental team member to learn how to use it?
So there's a lot of other features to it. It takes pretty much no time for someone to get used to using it. It just sort of happens. The way I set it up is that it just prompts you when it needs input. It is automated, but I call it semi-automated. My big fear with it when I was developing it was that it would do stuff that I didn't want it to do. So for example, it automatically asks patients who came into the office for a review on Google. And this is my office. We started with about 7 Google reviews a year and a half ago. And since implementing it, we have 220 5-star reviews.
Wow.
But my worry was that we would have a patient who, I mean, no matter how good a job you do, some people come in and they are looking for a fight. And so, you know, if that person comes in and they have a bad experience and we know about it, then there's a way that you can keep them from receiving this automated text message. So it was important to me that I, you know, do it well, but also that I'm able to protect my reputation. Additionally, I have it screen patients based on what procedure they're coming in for. So, you know, excluding procedures that may not be the most pleasant experiences. So part of the reason why we've gotten so many 5-star reviews at this office, and we're not a high volume practice by any means. If I get 10 new patients a month, that's a coup for us. But the reason that we're able to get so many 5-star reviews so quickly is by treating the patients well, but also this feature that I call auto texts, which are automatic end of the day text backs to patients. I have learned from you and from many others that one of the best ways that you can build a relationship with your patients quickly is to reach out to them and give them a call and, you know, see how they're doing after their procedures. And I always tried to do that, but something got in the way. I forgot to run the report, or my front desk forgot to run the report, or I had the report and then I had to run home and I left the report in my office and I couldn't make the calls. So consistency was really lacking on my part, and I really wanted to provide that extra level of care to my patients. So the way this auto text system works is at the end of the day, I get my little virtual assistant sends me an email like the one on the left, and it tells me who the patient is, which I grayed out for HIPAA, obviously. It tells me who the patient is, what procedure they had done today. And if you see the blue text on the side, those are all links. So I have a number of different options, and all I do is just click the link on my phone or on my computer, and exactly what's written on that email gets texted to the patient. So it really requires no effort and no thought on my part. It just sort of happens, and I can approve the patients that I want to contact. If it's someone who, for whatever reason, I don't, you know, feel the need to check in on them, this semi-automated system is not going to make a mistake. And then if you look on the right side, this is the best part of the job. It has improved my love of dentistry 10,000%, because every single day, at the end of the day, I get messages like this from my patients. These are actually from one of my associates, Dr. Mike. And I mean, imagine at the end of the day, you never get this as a dentist. All you get is the negative feedback. So imagine every day, at the end of the day, you reach out to your patients and they tell you how much they love you, how great everything is doing. It's not just the patients who, oh, this hurts and you ruined my tooth. And, you know, it's a lot of positive feedback, and it really makes you feel good about doing your job.
I am really impressed. When you and I first connected and you had told me about contact tracing, first of all, I thought that was brilliant and timely given the virus and the worldwide pandemic. But as I said to you earlier, before we started shooting today, when I really looked into the software and I had a deeper understanding of all the other things that it does, this isn't really just about contact tracing. This is really about patient communications, patient relations, a marketing angle of this as far as tracking, not just ROI, but really source tracking and going back to what was the source. It's brilliant. So I appreciate that you had the foresight to see a potentially difficult problem, the contact tracing, create a simple solution. But more so, I love the kind of suite that you've created. Maybe you call it Ape Suite. Zach, can you go into a little bit more detail? You and I spoke earlier today before we started shooting about the ROI tracking. And I love the contact tracing. The whole thing makes sense, but I'm into marketing. And I know it's so difficult to track ROI, track even the source of where each lead and or patient came from. So can you tell us more about that?
Yeah, sure. I had mentioned earlier that I can't even tell you how many times I've said, where did this patient hear about us? And I couldn't really get an answer. So I said, why don't I just automate that whole process? And so where we are now, returning to work after not working for 2.5 months, not bringing any money into the practice, I don't really feel like we can afford to just throw money at every marketing program there is without knowing what you're getting back from it. So the way that this marketing system works is it tracks the patient all the way through the entire process where they come to your practice. So for example, if a new patient calls the office, so I record the calls to make sure that the front desk is doing a good job. But on top of that, I'm also making sure that the patient became part of the practice. So it'll automatically look into the practice management software and see if that patient became a patient of the practice. And on top of that, since it's connected to the practice management software, it can see how much production came out of that patient. So from the beginning to the end, from that first phone call, I know whether or not that campaign is bringing in a lot of calls. I know whether or not my staff are converting those calls into actual patients of the practice. And then I know how much production is coming out of those patients in perpetuity. So it'll track it forever since it's built into the practice management software. So I can look back, you know, a year later and say, hey, we spent, you know, $10,000 on this magazine ad and it brought in $30,000. And I know that that number is going to be completely accurate. And so we can use that really to evaluate what our marketing spend is and trying to allocate money to the things that work versus the things that don't work. And the manual tracking of this stuff, if it's done perfectly, we'll do the exact same thing, but I don't know anyone in the world who's able to do that perfectly in a manual way. So in addition to tracking the marketing ROI, I really wanted it to be a way that I can automate the patient experience in the office and make sure that everyone's being treated well. You know, if you imagine doing it in one office is hard enough. If you're doing it in 6 offices, it's probably 10 times harder. And so some of the other cool features that I have as part of Ape, you can send gifts or mugs straight out of the practice management system. One of my key thoughts for developing this is that I really didn't want my staff to have to go to an outside portal to make this stuff happen. So all of these things are available straight out of a patient's chart, you know, whether you're using Dentrix or EagleSoft or Open Dental, you don't really have to open up another window to make this stuff happen. I know, Tom, that you're a big fan of sending new patients a gift or, you know, something to make them excited about coming into the office. And I can automate that whole thing. So if a new patient comes to the office, instead of having my staff, you know, pack something up or, you know, put paperwork together and mail it, they have to be very organized and at the end of the day do that stuff, you just click a button and the whole thing gets sent automatically. So the staff member gets prompted, you click the link, and then everything just does its thing. The thing I like most about it is you don't have to train or bonus any of your staff members. And if somebody leaves, which, you know, again, even in one practice is a big enough risk, but if you have a lot of practices, there's a lot of staff members and sometimes they come and go. If that really key person in your office ends up leaving, your patient experience doesn't suffer because the next person in line is just going to be prompted by Ape to do the right thing. So you can read more about it at covid.apedental.com. And with the coupon code ORENT1, I'll give you the first month of Ape Complete free. Or you can email me at ape@apedental.com. And if you'd like some more information, I can give it to you through that.
I got to tell you, my grandfather was in the hardware business and he loved kind of Rube Goldberg and MacGyver stuff he would put together. And I love that you made your own extra oil suction device. Can you walk us through that a bit?
Yeah, sure. Actually, my my Henry Schein rep calls me Dr. MacGyver. So I was working on this about 2 months ago. We started the whole process of trying to figure out what we were going to do when we got back to the offices. I'm part of a relatively small DSO. We have 6 offices. And from the very beginning, it was clear to us that the biggest priority was to make sure that our patients felt safe when they came back, but even more importantly, that our staff felt safe when we came back. So we spent a lot of time working on protocols. And one of the things we decided early on was that we wanted to introduce these extra oral suction machines to each operatory. So we started doing some investigation. There were significant price issues with buying 40 or 50 of these things at, you know, $3,000 a pop. And then when I called all the manufacturers, they were back ordered. They said they wouldn't even begin to start shipping until, you know, late June, July. And we had always had beginning of June as our relaunch date. So I started looking into how we could cost effectively introduce these to our offices and decided to just sort of build our own. So in evaluating how the other ones were made, I sort of learned that the thing that does the heavy lifting in all these extra oral suction units is the HEPA filter. And so I started looking into other things that had a HEPA filter and found this dust collector machine from Handler, which is a dental lab company. And in addition, found this hose that you can snap all these pieces together and then you bend it and it stays exactly where you put it. So the pieces seem to line up. We ordered a whole bunch of them and stuck them all together, and they really work great. I was just trimming yesterday a temporary crown, and I did it right in front of that orange bell, and all of the dust from the temporary crown usually is all over my pants, and there was nothing there. It all got sucked in there very well.
That's very cool. Very cool.
Yeah. So the pieces of this, the hose itself, the hose assembly costs, I think, maybe $35. And then the handler unit costs about $400. So all told, it's about $450. And, you know, when you buy 50 of them at that volume compared to the $3,000 unit, saves us quite a bit of money to sort of do it ourselves.
Very cool. And I see there's a link there as far as where you can get the hoses and that part. As far as the actual handler system itself, what I can do is, if you can shoot me an email, I'll put a link in the description below the video. So those watching the video, you guys can just go right to the description if you're interested in looking into that piece of equipment.
Great. So I'll just show you how it works. We just have a demonstration video here. And so this is actually my dad with a System B and just burning some gutta percha. He actually took a stocking and put it over the bell of the suction machine so that it wouldn't suck up a veneer or anything like that when he was trying to adjust it. And this is just burning some gutta percha, and you can see how well and how far away this machine is able to really reduce the amount of stuff that comes into the air. And so if you put this, you know, even 2 to 3 inches away from the patient's face, it's really not a big worry as far as aerosols escaping in combination with the assistant having a high-speed suction.
Yeah, I love the fact that you mentioned the high-speed suction, because I was having a similar interview a couple days ago with Gordon Christensen, and Gordon was talking about the number one thing is the assistant doing proper four-handed dentistry and having that suction at the right angle and so forth. So you know, kudos for mentioning that the combination is really very smart. There's a common misunderstanding. Let's talk about HEPA for a minute. There's a common misunderstanding of the particle size with respect to HEPA filtration. Can you talk about the MPPS?
Sure. So these are some commercially available shop vacs that have HEPA filters in them. And initially, when I was doing my search for how I was going to DIY these things myself, these were the two I decided that I would end up testing out before we found the handler unit. But the MPPS is the most penetrating particle size. And it's really fascinating the way these filters work. I had always thought that the way it works is sort of like a sieve, you know, and it's like the holes in the filter are only X size. And so if the particle is bigger than X, then it's not going to make its way through. Interestingly enough, the most penetrating particle size, which is 0.3 microns, is the size at which that particle is most likely to make it through the filter itself. Coronavirus, according to the CDC, the size of that is 0.125 microns. And the interesting thing is anything less than or more than 0.3 microns has a much higher chance of getting caught up in this filter. One of the reasons is that it doesn't just act like a sieve because the air is getting sucked in and the air has turbulence in it. These little particles end up smashing around all over the place. And that smaller particle size is swept up into the air current and it smashes up against the walls of the filter and it gets caught more efficiently. So that 0.3 microns exactly is the least filtrated, but anything greater or less than is going to be filtrated more.
Awesome. That makes a lot of sense. Zach, I really appreciate that you have the foresight to see a potentially difficult problem, and that is the contact tracing and what the CDC was talking about with respect to the virus. But now that I have a better understanding of the software, even more so, this goes way beyond contact tracing, and the marketing angles and the patient experience side of this are just tremendous. So again, thank you so much for sharing today.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thank you so much for having me.
Awesome. Take care. If you found this video helpful, subscribe to the channel and hit the bell notification so you won't miss a thing. If you're not yet a GEMS family member, Elizabeth and I would be delighted to help you build your practice and your revenue. We'd love to have you with us here on Planet GEMS for a time-limited offer, a free test drive of GEMS family membership. There's a link in the description below. If this was helpful, click like. And thanks so much for joining us here in the Dental Goldmine. Remember, you're only one gem away.